I introduce to you Mr. Peter Wilson, who publishes a Bodhi Tree News, and he is here for interview and asking some questions. So I will request him to please come and sit down here. Thank you. I have a copy of your questions here.
I'm not actually the publisher. I'm just a reporter.
A reporter.
Hastily conscripted for the job.
Yes.
So, shall I just get on with the questions? As you may be aware, the Bodhi Tree News is primarily a Buddhist magazine.
So there is some... magazine. Many magazines in the world, no?
Yeah.
So what is the speciality about this magazine, Buddhist magazine?
Yeah, it's supposed to be about Dharma.
Dharma. Mm-hmm. Yes, very good. So this Buddhist magazine is mainly for Dharma, and other magazines for Karma. Other magazines? Karma, yes. What magazine is there which is not dealing with karma? Activities.
Well, a bit of both, isn't it? A bit of both?
Yeah. Okay.
Well, can I go on with the question?
Okay. Then next, so what is the question here?
Is your teaching on emptiness, that is the emptiness of the self, essentially a synthesis of Buddhist and Hindu teaching?
No, there's a difference between the emptiness of the Buddhist and the emptiness of the Hindu teaching. There's a difference. And for the first time, you may hear it. Difference between emptiness and emptiness.
Very revealing. Very revealing.
So this question was already asked to me in Switzerland, where I used to talk in Sanan, where Krishnamurti always, every year during summer, went to give his talks, and people all over the world had gone to Switzerland. So in one summer I was also there and speaking separately somewhere else. Same place. So the people observed that my teaching and the teachings of the Krishnamurti are the same. So this dialogue was going on between people. I wasn't there, but I was informed later that someone who lectures on behalf of the Krishnamurti Foundation was there, and he said, Krishnamurti speaks different things, and Poonjaji speaks different emptiness, you see. So what is emptiness of Krishnamurti? He says, remove the concepts from the mind, and this is called freedom or emptiness, isn't it? If there is a vessel full of water, and you throw this water away from this vessel, it is empty, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And this is what Krishnamurti is speaking about emptiness. Empty the concepts of the mind and you are free. But what Poonjaji speaks is not only emptying the concepts, but also you have to break the vessel where these concepts are stored in. So Poonjaji breaks the vessel and Krishnamurti removes the concepts. That is the difference.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the difference between Buddhist emptiness and the emptiness of the Upanishads. So the Buddhist emptiness is they may be able to remove the concepts of the mind. Attachments of the mind, and go to the monasteries and then practice on emptiness, you see. So emptiness they are holding, emptiness they are attached to. So we have removed samsara and now we want freedom, and they are attached to emptiness now. I don't find any Buddhist who does not speak about emptiness. So they are attached to emptiness as they have been attached to things,
mm-hmm.
or ideas, or persons. So they say, even remove a person also. So they say, it is the Buddhists, they say, when you see Buddha, you kill Buddha, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Achha, Buddha is killed. That means person is killed. And they are attached to killing now. Whenever we see a person, we have to kill him. So the emptiness is now held by every Buddhist, and they don't get rid of this concept of emptiness. This is also a concept.
Mm-hmm.
I belong to samsara, I am bound concept. And now, to empty it, they are attached to emptiness. What difference is there? So in the Hindu Upanishads, they are not attached even to emptiness. You have to go beyond, and they say, aham brahm asmi. Mm. I am that itself. So no attachment to anything else, you see. I am Brahman, I am that itself. Not samsara, not nirvana even. So this is the only difference which I find.
But it's just words, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Surely the Buddhists are doing the same thing, attempting to do the same thing. The emptying of the vessel and the smashing of the vessel. What is the difference?
Difference is this.
One you do that and one you smash. Yeah.
Yes, therefore, what I speak is reject both.
Uh-huh.
Neither this nor that.
Right. Okay. One of the next questions. One of the most common things I have heard you say is just to sit and do nothing. Surely this is the ultimate goal of all the highest forms of yogic practice, especially those of Buddhist meditative techniques. Yet often you have appeared to dismiss such practices as unhelpful. Why is this?
Yes.
Same answer.
One of the common things I have heard you say is just to sit and do nothing. That's all I say. Just sit quietly and don't do anything, and also don't think about anything. So this is the ultimate goal of the highest form of yogic practices. So what I speak is not the practice of yoga even, you see. And this ultimate goal, I don't fix this ultimate goal. there is no goal, also I say. So you have not to make any effort to reach that goal. Because when you attain this goal after some time, after meditations, after yogic activities also, it means before you started it, you were not having this freedom which you have won after practice. Through yoga practice, you do anything, you may attain anything also. That is going to be the goal. But this, what you got out of this goal, was not there at the beginning. So whatever you attain or regain, this is due to your practices, and it means that it was absent when you started. As you want to buy a car of 94 model, which is not there, and you have to buy it, book it, reserve your car for this thing, and you have to arrange funds, borrow from the banks, or whatever it means. So now the car is not here. And with the arrangement of money, you will get it when it comes out of the factory. And now the car is not here. So like this, your goal to get a car will be fulfilled after your making efforts to collect your funds. So it's not here now today in front of your door. So like this, this nirvana, this liberation, freedom, is not now here, and you start practice. You may get it, but then it was absent before the practice. It was not there, therefore you had to do practice. But when you get it, it means this is the result of your practice that you got this liberation. Mm-hmm. And surely whatever you get or regain is going to be lost to you someday, because it was not already there. As this paper is in my hand, it was not there at 8 a.m. Now it is here. So when I finish with this thing, I have to finish with this thing, I will keep it aside. Again, after keeping it there, my hand is empty. Emptiness is there. No paper. Paper I got when I wanted it. And when it is over, again I return back to emptiness. So this emptiness was already there. So why to practice for this emptiness which is already there? So what I speak is, I don't speak about any nirvana or any liberation. I don't speak of it. I say, you are already liberated. Mm-hmm. And if this liberation is not there already, and you gain it after some time, with yogic exercises or meditations or concentrations, you are going to lose it one day. So what is gained and lost is not real. What it was before is real. Emptiness is real, which is already there. You are not to practice for it. So what is here now, you look at it now. It doesn't need any practice.
So what is before is real?
Yes.
But what is after is not?
No. What is before and after, both are unreal.
Both are real?
Both are unreal.
Unreal?
Yes. So which is not before or after, that is real.
You mean now is real?
Huh?
Now is real.
Now is real. Now is real, because now is neither past, nor future, nor present. Now will remain now, and you have not to get it by practice.
Mm-hmm. This is a good one. In Buddhism, As in most other religions, there are various gradations, that's degrees or levels of spiritual attainment, either explicitly stated or intrinsically implied. Is it possible to obtain genuine spiritual insight and an enlightenment to differing degrees, extents, or intensities? And if so, on what does this depend?
I never speak, first of all, on various gradations of spiritual attainments. I don't speak of this. It is no grades in this thing. Uh-huh. In emptiness, there are no grades that you have to practice and get one after the other. After explicitly stated, it's possible to obtain genuine spiritual insight and enlightenment to different degrees. I don't speak of degrees also. Uh-huh. There are no degrees, no gradations. You don't need anything because this depends, you speak of practice, you see. By practice, you got one stage. After deeper practice, you got another one, and there's no end of it, you see. Uh-huh. Therefore, I don't speak of there are any grades of enlightenment. What I speak is you are already enlightened.
Do individuals who are already enlightened all reflect that enlightenment in different ways?
There are no ways.
There are no ways.
No ways. In enlightenment, there are no ways, but in bondage, there may be. And bondage is a concept, you see. When a man is sick, he will call one doctor and ask him to cure his disease. So he tries, the disease is not cured. One stage is over. Another doctor is called to look after him. He also fails to cure this person from the disease. Third grade is over. Now a specialist comes, you see. He rejects all the previous things because he is a specialist. So his also doesn't work. So the patient has tried many doctors, one after the other, and these are the grades. But he has not recovered the disease. And disease was immediately gone when he died. After death, no doctor was called. After death, no doctor was called. Why? Yeah. Because there are no grades of sickness when a man dies. So this example I've given, you go on trying, your disease means your ego will not be cured. It will continue even after death. This man can cure his disease after death, but ego cannot be. Ego will take another form. So how to kill the ego? What they have trying, all the religions of the world have tried, and there is no product that a man who has been free from the ego. No one has done it. How to do, how it has been done? So there are many examples. The Buddha, Lord Buddha himself, has done it, you see. Not in stages, you see. Stages he passed, he went from center to center, ashram to ashram. People doing meditation constantly. He rejected, this not the way. Went to another one, this not the way one can be free. At one place he has gone, people hanging, head down and feet up, tied on the trees. so that no vasana comes in their mind. Then he said, not even this, hanging on the trees like bats. He goes. So he did not accept anything. Finally, he goes to Bodh Gaya, sat down under a Bodhi tree. Bodhi tree was name was given because the one prince was enlightened under that tree. There he simply quiet. He didn't do anything, neither eating nor going to bath. Simply got it, you see. He was enlightened. And Ananda was the first person. He asked him, Master, what is the experience? He kept quiet. So there starts the Buddhist emptiness, you see. Because Ananda is asking a question and Buddha is not speaking. How, when, what he got under the Bodhi tree. So this was attributed to emptiness. There start the concept of emptiness, you see. Keep empty. But Buddha, he received something. He became from Siddhartha to Buddha, Lord Buddha, you see. So he tried to speak what he gained for about 50 years. You see, at 30 years he got it, no? So 50 years at the end he could not describe what it was. This is called emptiness, which cannot be described by anyone so far. It cannot be polluted by word, by speech. That is called emptiness. So I believe that is the emptiness which cannot come by any practice and which cannot be touched by any concept, which is already there, everywhere it is there. But if you go to seek it, you can't. You can't seek it because there is nothing to seek, nothing to attain. When you give up this search and also concept of attainment regain, and then it is already there and you will see that it was there. Few will know it because everybody wants to do something. And by doing something, it's not going to be the result of any doing. So keep quiet. What I speak is keep quiet.
Okay.
Okay.
These all seem a little absurd, no? Continue.
Yeah.
We go on and on.
On and on.
And on.
Yeah.
And on. Yes, it does, doesn't it? In Mahayana Buddhism, it is suggested that in the fully conscious state, nirvana and samsara are realized as one and the same.
Same, yes, yes.
Is this true?
Yes, it is very true. What's the question? Fully conscious state. Nirvana and samsara are realized as one and the same. Is this true? It is very true, but you have just turned over to next question. Now I have to ask you a question. What is nirvana? What is Nirvana and samsara are realized as one and at the same. So what is nirvana?
Samsara.
Samsara. So all this is samsara. All this is samsara. How they can become the same, samsara and nirvana? So you yourself admit that you have not to do any practice to win nirvana. If they are same, everybody is samsara, why
well,
to do
practice? One can practice or not practice, it's up to the individual, isn't it?
What you attain by practice, I have already said, you are going to lose it.
Yes.
Because it wasn't there.
Yes.
So samsara is there, everybody is in samsara, why you should practice for nirvana?
People do.
People do it, yes, yes. But the Buddhist people do it, others don't do it.
Well, that is what is Buddha is. That is that these are the words that are described.
Yes, yes, whole world is called samsara. So this is a concept. This is a concept. Then the Buddhists have another concept of nirvana. How it can be one? Both are concepts.
Mm-hmm.
To remove the concept of samsara, you go to the monastery and they teach you and load another concept on your head of nirvana. And you start practicing that concept. So concept is a concept. Why not to remove both the concepts? So it's not that nirvana and the samsara are the same, but removing both the concepts is that.
Yes.
Removing both, don't speak of samsara and nirvana. Nirvana means the absolute abandonment of the consciousness, you see, of the desire. So that is called nirvana. And extinction, final liberation is called nirvana. Final liberation from the matter and the reunion with the with some spirit or some stage. Complete abandon that concept that you have got to win something. This is called nirvana. Eternal freedom, eternal bliss, eternal happiness, which is already here and now.
Mm-hmm.
But if you speak of samsara and nirvana, it will never happen. So you have to realize that there's nothing to attain, nothing to lose. Nothing to attain, nothing to lose. This is called nirvana. Whatever happens in front of you, accept it. Whatever doesn't happen, don't reject, because it is already not there. So this question once was asked by a student to a teacher, how to get rid of this samsara and attain nirvana. This had been asked some generations ago. And then this teacher said, I will reply you, how to get rid of this samsara, very troublesome samsara, nobody is happy in this samsara. So I will tell you how to get rid of this and attain nirvana. So the master one day was going along with this, his student. He sat under a tree, he said, I am very thirsty and here at the river, you go and fetch me some water so that I drink here. And this river was about 10 yards from this tree where he sat down, you see. So he took a pitcher to bring the water for the master. So there he put the vessel into the water. There stood a very beautiful girl who came to fetch water. So he looked at her and fell in love with her, this girl. pitcher in hand into the water of the river, eyes fixed with the eyes of this beautiful girl. And seeing, he offers, "Will you marry me?" And then this girl says, "No, here the custom of this place is, the girls are married by their parents. So I love you and you love me, but you have to ask my father. So if I go, I will show you who my father is. I will not come with you. I will go from the back door and listen to what you speak. You speak because you said you have graduated yourself in many sciences. You tell to my father, and our caste is the same, there can be no problems." So this girl showed him, there sat my father speaking to his other farmers who are tilling our lands, and we are the owner of this village. You speak to my father. And he went, you know, saw the father. He asked him about his education, and he said, "Yes, I have graduated in philosophy, psychology, mythology, and astronomy, and geology." And he counted many things, he counted. So he's very happy. He said, "I have only one daughter, and I love her most because I have no son. So my condition is, you have to stay here, and you have every right to become the owner of this village when we die. So you don't take away my daughter to your place. You have to stay here." He agrees. Now some 2 years have passed. He gets a son. He gets a son. And another 4 years, he gets a daughter. Then about 11 years, he got another son. Three children, now they're very happy, you see. And his father-in-law and mother-in-law both died. Now he, his wife, are the owner of this whole village and cultivation, you see. So once in, after 15 years or so after the marriage, the river, there was a spate floods in the river, and river is now rising slowly, foot by foot. So it reaches the house, all houses drowned in the water. Then they go on the ridge of the mountain, standing there. All is drowned, everywhere there's water. And now slowly the water is getting very strong, and this man is now grasping the hand of his wife. One daughter here, small children on the shoulders, you see. So somehow this child slipped away from the hand, and being washed in the current, he went to catch hold of his son, and the wife slipped away. And then he is going to trace both of them. Both the children have gone into the water and lost. And now this man is now suffering, you see. "I have lost my wife, I have lost my children, I have lost everything, my cattle is dead, and my fields are gone." And slowly, river is now receding, slowly, quietly, receding. And now he is crying, weeping, suffering in grief, lost everything, lost the village, and lost his wife and sons. He is sitting like this thing in great grief. And then his teacher comes. He says, "What are you thinking about? Why don't you take this vessel out of the water?" He said, "Thinking? What about my wife, children, house? Where are they?" I say, "This you are thinking. Just now you came, I told you to bring me water, and you have kept this water inside. Take it out. Take it out. Nothing has happened. Just seconds ago you came. And it shouldn't take more than 5 seconds or 1 minute to bring the water back to me. But you thought, in this thought, he created time. He created space. He created relationships. He married. Time also came. Years also came in this single thought. It's a single thought. Yes, yes, of course. You see, I am here, you are there, water is here. Where did you go? So this is the samsara, your own creation. Your own creation and get attached to things which never happened before. He was as it is, bringing, taking water, that's all. Thought came. That thought created the beauty on a woman, marriage. All these things depend in your thought. So what I speak with you, with everybody, is don't think. If you do, this thing is going to happen. This samsara is your own creation. Then all these relationships, marriages, wives, daughters, sons, is your own creation. Therefore, if you don't think, nothing will happen. Nothing has happened. You stop thinking. And this is called nirvana. You stop thinking for 1 second and you are free wherever you are.
I believe you. Yes.
That's right.
Papaji, if this is all our creation, is it perhaps this whole world that we live in is like a communal creation?
Okay, I tell you, I told this story also, and you are not satisfied. In your own case, in your own experience, I am going to tell you. So, when you sleep, and then you dream, in that dream, you see mountains, you see animals, you see forest, you see men, you see animals, isn't it? Don't you see? In the dream...
I don't see a lot now.
In the dreams, don't you see these things? Everybody dreams. In the dream, he will see men, his own relations, he sees mountains. So maybe 5 minutes dream, he will see a mountain. And mountain is not less than 2 billion years old. Instantly creation, mountain. Then come to the men. One man is old man, one is a child. Old man of 80, child is 10. 70 years difference between the two. All happened at the same time in 5 minutes. One is 100 year old, one is 10 year old, one is not yet born also. So how this happens when you are dreaming, this happens. And some are Buddhists, some belong to other religions. And these Buddhists are concentrating meditation and get nirvana, and others are enjoying their lives, whatever way they like. So one, after meditation, he has won nirvana. Others are still in samsara. By the way, you wake up. You wake up, your dream is gone. So what is the difference between one who has won freedom and the other not? One is become Buddhist, other belong to other religions. One is free, others are bound. What is the difference between one who is bound and one who is liberated in dream when you wake up? What is the difference? And what about those who have won nirvana and about those who have yet bound to their senses. What is the difference?
The difference is in their personal experience.
Personal, yes, yes. Personal experience, that's what I say. You see many people in the dream, when you wake up, you don't see them. Some are suffering, some are happy. What is the difference, one who's suffering and one who's happy, when you wake up? So when you wake up, then you speak about this thing. Wake up means know your own self and not dream. All this is a dream. When you see any name and form, you are dreaming. When you don't think of any name, any form, that is called waking state. And that is going to happen when you are really awake to your own consciousness, you see, supreme consciousness. Otherwise, this dream is continuing for millions and billions of years. It's not going to end because this is your own creation. It comes out of thought. Unless you destroy the root of this thought, this dream will continue.
You do not want the dream to continue?
If you don't want, strike at the root of the mind. If you don't want, if it troubles you, then strike at the root. If you're happy with it, stay on.
Ah. Okay. it's a deal. Next question?
Yeah.
You direct people to seek and find the source of all things, the seat of the self from which all things arise. Is this self then the creator of all things, in effect the God of all creation? I think we just said that.
It's called.
If so, then is this our true self who is continually creating more and more forms of itself to gain ever more complex and subtle tactile experience of itself? And is this what is called the play of Leela?
This Leela is this samsara, and this happens, this is created when you think. That's why it's called Leela. If you call it Leela, if you take it as Leela, then there's no samsara and no nirvana, and they both are the same. When you call it Leela, Leela means sports, isn't it?
Sports.
Game, yes, yeah. Game. Or a drama. This is called Leela. Drama is happening. As in the drama, many actors are working on the stage. Many are working. Some is a dacoit, one is a king, other is a policeman, isn't it? Mm. On the theater, all these roles are played. So one is a king, one is a robber, one is robbed, and they display on the stage. So audience is looking, you see. Audience are looking at this game. But someone are so engrossed in this game that they think that it's a reality what is playing on the stage. It's very real. If somebody has murdered someone, he is killed, the killer is there, the killer ran away. So they are attached to this and forget that they are the audience and watching this theater. And those who forget suffer. Those who see that we have come to a theater and this is only a drama played on this, they are the happiest lost. See. So this drama will be played, the drama will begin, stay, and will finish. So what will remain? Only the screen, the white screen. it has not changed with the bullets of the rifle, no hole in it. The river flowed, it was not wet. Fire was there, it is not burnt. This was only a theater. So after that, the screen remained as the screen is. Now, if you think this is the consciousness, nothing ever can happen to it. And you are free, you are happy. But if you are attached, what happened to this man? He was murdered for simply nothing, no reason. So this is everybody's thinking. So they forget that this is a theater. So if you see a theater as a theater, you will not be in trouble. But you forget, all this is real. Somebody dies, you suffer. Somebody comes near you and loves you, you are happy. So those are the person who will suffer in the end. Whatever happens, call it, it's a happening. Neither get attached, nor detached.
But wouldn't it be nice to create a very beautiful play rather than a very harmful play, a hurtful play?
Yes, very beautiful. Creation is very beautiful, very helpful, very lovely. How long it will stay? How long? If you have even...
As long as we wish to continue creating.
Yes, I tell you, this looks beautiful. Everything looks beautiful. And when you have diarrhea, will this look beautiful to you? Yes, when you have diarrhea.
It's fairly unpleasant.
And any person comes and invites you, you come...
But it doesn't last, does it? It doesn't last.
It doesn't last, that's what I say. It doesn't last because it depends upon your experience. When you are happy, you like it. So this happiness depends upon you. You must be there in good shape. And when you have diarrhea, the same person you don't like, she comes and invites you, but said, no, today I am having in diarrhea, I can't go with you. So this depends on you. You must be in good shape. Good shape means you must have wisdom. You must have wisdom. This is not real, so I should not love it. What is not real, I should not love it, you see. So that is the difference. It depends on you. Good shape, keep yourself. Good shape means pure mind. So whatever happens, let it happen. What is not happening, don't care for it. This is called enlightenment.
I'm doing my best. When I was here in April last, I remember that you had requested no further questions on the environment. Why was this? And do you intend to continue this request?
That I told you, you don't care for environment because most people, when they join the monasteries, most Buddhists also, and most Christian missionaries also, they go out to help the people, isn't it? Help the people, and they go on helping for some definite reason. There must be some interest in helping others. At least the one to convert those people, if it's a Christian missionary, to make them Christians. If it is Buddhist, to make them Buddhist, you see, this is the interest of keeping looking for the environment, the change the environment to become better. This environment will never become better, you see. This is the result of your own thinking. So if you take care of this environment, you have lost your own time to improve your own environment.
What about the natural environment that we all share, the planet Earth? What about the natural environment we all share, that is the planet Earth?
This natural environment is not real. It was not there before. How you call this natural environment? Before the beginning of this natural environment, were you there? Before the creation, were you there? Did you see the creation of this samsara, this world? Did you witness it?
Not as a personal individual.
Okay, so you didn't do it. After 100 years, will you take care of this environment? After 100 years, now, from now, will
not you as a, not as a personal individual, no.
Okay, no. Never before nor after. So this is during this 100 years that you have become the owner of this samsara to change the nirvana and to take care of the environment and the suffering of the people for 100 years. And this samsara, this world, this creation belongs 2 billion years already, this thing. Who took care of this for 2 billion years? Who is the owner of this business? He will take care of it. You take care of yourself. Then the rest will be taken care of by themselves, by one who has produced them, by one who has created this samsara, will take care of them. And perhaps he also will change.
But isn't that our true self, the one who has created?
True self has not created anything.
Ah.
Why should he create things? Is he not happy without things? Why should he create things and get involved with these things, you see? Why should? What is the idea of creation? If he has got any idea of creation or a thought of creation, he is not a perfect creator.
That surely is the point from which all things arise.
Yes. Yes, from where the things arise, they arise from your mind, not from his mind.
Ah.
Yes, you think about it.
But ultimately I am him, and you are him.
If you are thinking that I am him, you are saying this is not your experience. When you say I am him, the I is no more there than him is, isn't it? Let him take care of himself, you take care of yourself.
Okay. Last question. I have heard that according to Hindu cosmology, this is the age of Kali Yuga, one of considerable spiritual deprivation. Is this true? And do you know how long it will last?
This is for the cosmologists to think about it, but they say this Kali Yuga is the fourth Yuga. It's the fourth Yuga, means 4 billion of time. Mm-hmm. There are 4 Yugas, you see.
From the beginning of time?
Beginning, yes, Satya Yuga, and then Dwapar, then Kali Yuga it comes, you see. So this is the last, and they fixed the life of this Yuga 12,000 years. 12,000 years, and this Yuga is, and these 4 Yugas are 25,000 years, and then they will go back. Still, this is not the end. Mm. Kalpa is there, kalpa again, time does, you see. And these yugas will go on and on, endlessly, these yugas. Dwapar will be there, Treta will be there, Satyuga will be there, Kalyuga will be there. This will also go on revolving unless one knows that there is no time. And this time is the same, a thought of your mind. When you think, the time rises. When your time rises, then these yugas will rise. You see, yugas are in the time. As I told you, 25,000 in time. So when you think, time will rise. When you don't think, there are no yugas and no kalpas. You remain completely free, empty. That emptiness, I say, you see, where nothing ever existed. Even now, nothing ever exists. And this is called freedom from time. This is nirvana.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your coming visit here. Thank you very much.
I would like to stay a little longer. Yeah. And the request of a dying man, one last request. May I speak to you sometime in the future about my personal experiences?
Yes, I'll be very happy.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'll be very happy to listen to you. So whenever you are free to tell me your experiences, I am always available.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sure.
Okay.